Yes, thank you very much for inviting me to this seminar. My background is probably different than most of other persons in this conference because I don't have any background in economy, but I'm epidemiologist, and so I will talk about this issue from quite different perspective than these two previous presentations. But this is my title about the presentation, but it's very poor, but I will bit more focus it because I will mainly talk about how human anthropometrics can be used as an indicator of childhood living conditions, especially childhood nutrition, and how human anthropometric is associated with adult health, especially in chronic diseases. But just to bit motivate this presentation, this is probably very clear. It's childhood is very important part of human life. There is a lot of speculation and quite a lot of evidence as well that undernutrition in childhood, it has a very long-lasting effect on human metabolism. But also, there may be more behavioral factors explaining the association between childhood and adult health, because we learn also many health habits at home, and so we can think that there is also this kind of behavior factors explaining associations between childhood and adulthood. However, it's very difficult to measure human nutrition because, of course, we could use surveys, but it is notoriously difficult to measure nutrition even in adulthood and not to speak in childhood. On the other hand, we can use register-based information collected by United Nations, but it gives only information about food consumption in area level, but we don't know anything about how this food is distributed within populations. And so, as Yuko will explain in her presentations, height has been used quite a lot as an indicator of childhood nutrition, history of economics, but also it can be used in modern day epidemiology because human growth is very sensitive for nutrition, and so we can think that if there is an undernutrition for this particular child, it can be seen as a shorter body height. This is just to illustrate that how important phase of life childhood is in the formation of the adult anthropometrics. It is of course very very important for height because height doesn't change anymore in adulthood, except slight shrink in old age. But this is this trait correlation, and we can see that already at 5 years of age, the correlation with adult height is about 0.8. And even for BMI, it's quite high, it's 0.6, but then it's rapidly increasing, and so there is strong tracking in BMI also in between childhood and adulthood. There is, of course, some decrease here just because of the puberty. And because we had a twin data used in this study, we were able to decompose this correlation to genetic and environmental correlations. And maybe not surprisingly, most part of this correlation between childhood and adulthood in height was explained by genetic correlation. It's here. It's even higher than this trait correlation. And there's also a strong genetic correlation in explaining BMI between childhood and adult BMI. And this is what Yuko already told, that height can be used as an indicator of childhood living conditions. At the population level, height is very much differences in height is very much explained by genetic factors. We have studied in this slide by using twin studies from different populations how much the genetic and environmental factors contribute to differences in height within these populations, and we can see that around 80% of the variation of height is because of the genetic differences between individuals. But there's also about from 20 to 10% of the variation can be explained by some factors common for these coat fins. And they can be, for example, some factors related to childhood socioeconomic background or this type of factors shared by coat fins. And then we have about same amount of the variation is explained by specific environmental factors for each twin individual, and this also includes a measurement error. So there may be some real environmental factors affecting individually for both twins, but also some part of this variation is just because of the measurement error. And we can use this at the population level, even when major part of this variation is because of genetic differences. We can use height as an indicator of like in economy or like general welfare. And this is an example about the two Nordic countries, my home country Finland and Sweden. And this is how adult height vary according to birth cohort. And Finland, before the Second World War, Finland was a pretty poor country, about the level of the current developing countries. And we can see it as a shorter adult mean height in these cohorts born before Second World War. And this is seen both in men and women. But when we come these cohorts born after Second World War, we see that this difference in mean height, it has rapidly decreased. And this will demonstrate that how sensitive this mean body height of the population is to other indicators of the economy, economy in this nation. But and this is some global indicators about stunting of preschool children, and this well corresponds to the results Yuko showed us about childhood mortality. We see that this prevalence is very high in African countries, but at least for me it's quite surprising or even shocking that it is very high also in India, because India is not maybe it's a poor country or middle-income country, but it's much more affluent country than many African countries. And this may be because of the pure hygiene level in many areas of India. So this is not necessarily only because of the national cross-national product of this kind of economic indicators, but it can also be because of the level of childhood diseases. But what is the importance of height for diseases? In this study, we look at the association between height in childhood and adult mortality from cardiovascular in coronary heart disease in this slide. And this shows that one increase in the standard deviation of this adult this childhood height, it's associated with a lower risk of coronary heart disease. This is hazard ratios, and so these hazard ratios lower than one indicates a lower risk to die from coronary heart disease. And we can see that this is especially high in childhood. It's somewhat this association somewhat decrease, coming closer to one in when looking this later height, and so this indicates that especially childhood height would be the most informative indicator of the nutrition. And when look at adult height, there's some catch-up growth, and so this association become somewhat weaker. But still, if you look at adult height, we can still find an association between tall stature and lower risk of coronary heart disease or other cardiovascular diseases. But this association between height and health, it's not limited only to physical diseases. In this study, we analyzed the association between height and cognitive performance of elderly twins. in Finland and Denmark. This may be a bit difficult to read this table, but I have summarized the main message of this table here, and we can see that there is an those elderly persons who are short, they have a lower cognitive performance in their old age than those who are tall ones. And then we can see a very similar trend both in Finland and in Denmark. Please don't pay attention on these absolute numbers, because this we use the same score here, but this Danish elderly persons were much older when the survey was conducted, and that's why this level of the cognitive performances is lower in this Danish survey, but still this height gradient is exactly the same. However, at the moment, undernutrition, it is not so much problem anymore, even in middle-income societies. It's overnutrition, it's become much more important problem. However, it's surprising that these two opposites parts of nutrition, they are not necessarily a contradictory, because we can find in societies we're actually suffering a double burden, that they suffer both from malnutrition and for excess nutrition. And this can also be clustered in the same families. We can, for example, we can well think that if the nutrition is poor quality, the children may develop a lack of different micronutrients, but still they have too much energy, and so they develop obesity in adulthood. And of course, an obesity is associated with a lot of chronic diseases. And this is a map of childhood overweight in different countries, and we see that it's especially difficult in Mexico, and in United States it's even higher in Mexico, and then it's not so big problem in Asia, and actually very low prevalence in Japan. And this is the results for girls. This very big difference between Finland and Japan, Finland here and Japan here. We started the study to analyze the socioeconomic differences in BMI in Helsinki and in Toyama, in civil servants, and we found that in Helsinki there is a very steep gradient, socioeconomic gradient in BMI, so that those who are in manual workers, they have a higher BMI than those who are managers. But in Japan, not only the level of BMI is much lower, but in Japan we couldn't find any evidence about this socioeconomic gradient. And the results are very similar for females as well. And this country occupation interaction effect is statistically highly significant for males and females. Just like in height, also for BMI, BMI, the most part of the individual differences come from genetic factors. This is a meta-analysis of 19 studies, and we found that over the childhood and adolescence, from 70 to 90% of the variation after mid-childhood can be explained by genetic factors. However, this genetic component is not independent of environment. In this study, we found that those who have a high physical activity, actually this genetic variation is lower than those who have a sedentary lifestyle. And so you can, by physical exercise, you can kind of suppress the genetic effect on obesity. And the very similar results were found in molecular genetic studies. This is genetic risk score of 16 known alleles risk alleles of BMI, and we can see that this in those who have a high genetic risk score of obesity, they have a big difference between those who are physically active and those who are inactive, but we see only little difference in those who have at a low level of this genetic risk score. So a couple of general conclusions. Childhood nutrition, it has long-lasting health effects. It has effects not only on physical health, but also mental health. And like in these two previous presentations, also this emphasizes how important it is that we invest for balanced nutrition in childhood, because it has a very long-lasting effects, even decades. However, in Western societies and increasingly also in middle-income societies, obesity is actually becoming a more important problem than malnutrition. And hopefully we can get more information about this in the future, because these genetic and environmental factors, they are not operating independently, but there is an interaction effect also. And so hopefully in the future we can get more information that how this kind of macro environment, how it modifies socioeconomic differences and genetic differences affecting BMI. I'm just finishing soon. This is just to show that what information we will get in the future. This is a new Coda Twins project I'm heading, and we have collected information on about 50 twin cohorts from 22 countries, information about height and BMI, and also education, and some baseline information, and it's collected here in Helsinki, and hopefully based on this database we can get more information how macro environment modifies the genetic and environmental variation in height and body mass index. Just thank you very much for all you and all twins. They are young. We have about half a million twins in this register, and this is two ones, very young twins from Osaka Twin Festival. I was fortunate to participate last year, and thank you for listening.